quality of smooth and cardiac muscle. In this lecture, we will cover the mechanisms of contraction of smooth muscle and cardiac muscle. That is the histological appearance of skeletal, cardiac, and smooth muscle. We studied previously skeletal muscle and we identified that they are striated. And the same for the cardiac muscle with the presence of the intercalated discs, and the branching of the muscle fiber. Today we are going to cover smooth muscles. They are small, unstriated, and they are smooth, spindle-shaped. Functional anatomy of smooth muscles. The smooth muscles, not arranged as symmetrically as in skeletal muscle, no striations. Filaments are oriented in obliquely. The filaments are attached to the dense bodies instead of the Z lines, and the filaments are stretched from one dense body to another. Dense bodies instead of Z lines have non-contractile intermediate filaments, that connect the dense bodies together. Contraction pulls dense bodies together. Contain only a small amount of stored calcium, which is present in something called cavuli in the cell membrane. Smooth muscle contain actin, myosin, tropomyosin, but no troponin. Tropomyosin is present but has no known function, or its function is unknown. More actin than myosin. Arrangement of contractile filaments. That is the thin actin filaments, and that is the dense bodies. And we have here the thick myosin filaments, And if we look to the attachment, we have one contractile unit in the relaxed state, and that is the shape in the contractile state. That is the myosin thick filaments, that is the actin thin filaments, and usually the mechanism of contraction is dependent on the sliding of actin over myosin. 15 thin filaments to thick filaments. This means that the ratio between thin filaments to thick filament in smooth muscle is higher than to that in skeletal muscle, which is 2 thin to 1 thick. There is something which is called the oblique orientation. That is the dense bodies. It is a form of the protein known as alpha actinin, and that is the non-contractile intermediate filament that connect the dense bodies together. Dense bodies gives attachment to the actin filaments, and the contraction of the smooth muscle is dependent on the sliding of actin over myosin. Types of smooth muscles. Both innervated by autonomic nervous system. The smooth single unit smooth muscle fiber. The multi-unit smooth muscle fibers. Single unit, they work as one unit or one syncytium. Here they are multiple units. Multi-unit cells or group of cells act independent units, like the iris muscles or the dilator pupillae, constrictor pupillae muscles of the iris, the erector pili muscle of the hair of the skin, visceral or unitary smooth muscle or single unit. It is the same name, single unit smooth muscle fiber. Only a few muscle fiber innervated in each group. This means that the innervation is usually go to the smooth muscles that's located on the surface. Impulse spread through gap junction. Impulses spread through gap junction from the smooth muscle that's located on the surface to the deep smooth muscle fibers. They are present as a whole sheet. They are present as a sheet that's usually going to contract together. They are often autorhythmic, with the meaning of often. Autorhythmic. Some of the smooth muscle fiber, usually those located on the surface, have the capacity to generate action potential spontaneously. And this action potential can spread to the remaining or the neighbor's smooth muscles by the gap junction. In this figure, we have the autonomic nerves. And these autonomic nerves contain varicosities that contain the vesicles of the neurotransmitter. These vesicles are going to be secreted to the smooth muscles located on the surface, changing their activity, and then what's going? The excitation wave or the hyperpolarization wave will spread from one muscle fiber to the next through the gap junction. Single unit smooth muscle fiber function as a syncytium. And if we look here, that's the membrane potential. That is the membrane potential generated in the gastrointestinal smooth muscle cells. And that is in the resting states, we have slow waves of depolarization. These slow waves of depolarization can be excited more or can be facilitated to produce spikes of potential, or more depolarization, as occur by stretch or by acetylcholine or parasympathetic nervous system, or it can be inhibited showing hyperpolarization by norepinephrine and thrombocytic. So that is the shape of the electrical activity or the recording of the electrical activity in the gastrointestinal smooth muscle cells. They can be stimulated by stretch, acetylcholine, and parasympathetic, inhibited or showing hyperpolarization by norepinephrine and sympathetic. It has a myogenic activity, can excite itself because it contains self-exciting cells, which is the base maker, because they have unstable membrane potential. So they have myogenic activity, and in response to this myogenic activity, they can generate the action spontaneously. Mechanism of smooth muscle contraction. The mechanism of smooth muscle contraction is dependent on the increase of the calcium concentration in the cytoplasm. Calcium comes from extracellular fluid or from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, bind with calmodulin, and when it binds with calmodulin, forming calcium-calmodulin complex, activates myosin light chain kinase enzyme, and this myosin light chain kinase produce phosphorylation of the head of myosin, and when it phosphorylates the head of myosin, it produces sliding of actin over the myosin, and smooth muscle contraction. Smooth muscle relaxation is dependent on the pumping of calcium to the sarcoplasmic reticulum or to the extracellular fluid. And this will activate another enzyme which is called the myosin phosphatase. Activation of myosin phosphatase dephosphorylates the head of myosin, so less binding of actin to myosin, so decrease in the muscle tension or relaxation. So again, pumping of the calcium to the sarcoplasmic reticulum or to the extracellular fluid will produce dissociation of calcium from calmodulin. Activates the myosin phosphatase, enzyme, and in this state it will produce muscle relaxation. Shortening of the smooth muscle cell during contraction. During contraction, the sliding of filament generates tension. The sliding of actin filaments over myosin filament generate tension. and this tension is transmitted to the non-contractile intermediate filaments. This tension is transmitted to the non-contractile intermediate filament, and this in turn produce pulling on the dense bodies that's attached to the sarcolemma, causing a lengthwise shortening of the muscle fiber, causing a lengthwise shortening of the muscle fibers. Smooth muscle tone and degradation of contraction. Smooth muscle tone is usually present in single unit smooth muscle fiber, and in this state we have a partial contraction and sustained for a long term tone, that's low level of tension. So for example, if you look to the blood vessels, normally if you find the blood vessel usually is present in a state of a partial vasoconstriction, not completely dilated, not completely constricted. And if you remember, we have something which is called sympathetic tone that supplied the blood vessels to maintain them in a partially constricted state, to maintain the peripheral resistance and also to maintain the blood pressure. And this tone, which is a state of maintained contraction present in the smooth muscle, is maintained by the continuous innervation by the sympathetic nervous system that secrete the norepinephrine on the smooth muscle to maintain their partial degree of contraction or the partial degree of vasoconstriction in the blood vessel. If you increase the amount of norepinephrine, you are going to increase the degree of contraction of the muscles. If you decrease the norepinephrine, you are going to decrease the degree of contraction of the smooth muscles and decreasing the vasoconstriction or producing vasodilatation. So this tone is important for some organs like the gastrointestinal tract and for the blood vessel, as we mentioned. But we have something which is called the gradation of contraction, the meaning of gradation of contraction. This means that the smooth muscle response is variable, it is not the same, and this is dependent on the calcium content. What's the meaning of the calcium content? If you increase the amount of calcium inside the smooth muscle, you're going to produce more contraction. The degree of contraction in the muscle will increase. So regarding or according to the intracellular calcium level, the degree of contraction of the smooth muscles will increase, and there will be a gradation. Gradation means a gradual increase in the response, Here, it is dependent on the intracellular calcium level. It cannot be done by recruitment like skeletal muscle, as all the fibers are connected by gap junction, so always contract as one unit. So, in skeletal muscle, gradation can be done by recruitment, by stimulating of more muscle fiber. Cannot done here in skeletal and smooth muscle by this. It is dependent on the change in the calcium concentration. Increasing the calcium concentration in the side the smooth muscle will increase the force of contraction. Properties of single unit smooth muscle cells. Number one, they have gap junction, allowing the depolarization wave to spread from one muscle fiber to the next. Some of the single unit smooth muscle fiber have the capacity to generate action potential spontaneously, so they are named as a pacemaker. Usually the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nerves are supplying the pacemaker cells, so they usually the innervation is limited to few cells. Single unit smooth muscle of the gastrointestinal tract and of the blood vessel have something which is called tone, and this tone is produced by its myogenic activity. The tension can increase or decrease in the smooth muscles of a single unit by either increasing the activity of myosin light chain kinase or activating myosin light chain phosphatase. The contraction of the single unit smooth muscle fiber is graded according to the change in the intracellular calcium level. Response of the single unit smooth muscle fiber to stretch. In response to stretch, there is relaxation. In response to prolonged stretch, there is relaxation. In response to prolonged stretch, this is called the stretch relaxation response, the stress relaxation response of the smooth muscles. The stress relaxation response of the smooth muscles means with maintained or prolonged stretch of the smooth muscle, they show something which is called relaxation. But sudden stretch of the smooth muscles may produce contraction. Factors affecting smooth muscle contraction. Autonomic nervous system. Single unit smooth muscle fiber are usually supplied by both divisions of the autonomic nervous system, sympathetic and parasympathetic. And both sympathetic and parasympathetic are not initiating the contraction. They modify the activity, either increasing the activity or decreasing the activity. For example, we have a specific or a special degree of contraction present in the smooth muscles of the gastrointestinal tract. Parasympathetic increase the activity, increase the degree of tension, decrease the degree of contraction in the muscle, while the sympathetic is going to inhibit or decrease. For example, if we are talking about the sphincters present in the gastrointestinal tract, usually the parasympathetic is produced relaxation of sphincters, while the sympathetic produce contraction of sphincter. This means that it's not initiating the activity, they are modifying the activity. Receptors are dispersed all over the muscle, not like skeletal muscle on the end blade only. The neurotransmitters are released from the postganglionic varicosities, the postganglionic neurons within its multiple varicosities, to many receptor types of the smooth muscles. One smooth muscle can be influenced by many neurotransmitters according to the amount of receptors or the types of the receptor located on their membrane. Mechanical stretch of the urinary bladder, stomach myogenic response of the blood vessels. So, some smooth muscles can respond to stretch and produce contraction in response to stretch. Hormones, vasopressin, stimulates the contraction of the vascular smooth muscles. Epinephrine relaxes the airways and produces bronchodilation. Metabolites like potassium, hydrogen, and carbon dioxide can affect the degree of smooth muscle contraction or relaxation. Comparison of smooth muscle contraction and skeletal muscle contraction. In this diagram, we have here the tension developed in three muscles, skeletal, cardiac, and smooth muscles against time. And we will find that the smooth muscle produces slow contraction and slow relaxation compared to both skeletal and cardiac muscle. So why smooth muscle show slow contraction and relaxation versus skeletal and cardiac muscle? Number one, the slow cycling of the myosin cross bridges. The myosin cross bridges produce slow cycling. Number two, it takes longer time for the calcium to reach to the contractile elements. In skeletal muscle, we have the two T-tubules that, when stimulated by depolarization, allows the calcium to come rapidly from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. But here, in the smooth muscle, we have poorly developed sarcoplasmic reticulum. And the calcium is coming either from the ligand-gated channels or the voltage-gated channels, then bind with calmodulin. When it binds with calmodulin, it will activate the myosin light-chain kinase, and this takes a long time to produce the tension needed in the muscle. The maximum force of contraction is often greater in smooth muscle than in skeletal muscle. And this can be recorded in sphincters, like the internal anal sphincter or the internal urethral sphincter. These sphincters produce what? Produce tonic maintained contraction to prevent the escape of urine or stool. They are considered economic. Smooth muscles are considered economic. They consume little amount of energy to maintain contraction because of latch phenomenon. Smooth muscles can contract and relax in response to other factors, not only action potential. They can respond to blood gases, they can produce response to hormones, they can respond to mechanical factor as a stretch, but the skeletal muscle responds only to nerve impulse. Latch phenomenon. Once smooth muscle has developed full contraction, the degree of activation and the ATP use can be reduced to a level far below those of initiation of contraction. What is the meaning of that? Once the smooth muscle generates the needed attention, what's going, the head of myosin will remain. For example, that is the head of myosin, and when the muscle delivered the tension she needs, what's going, the head of myosin is going to completely bind and remain bound to what? To the actin binding sites. They are going to maintain the binding with the actin binding sites, and when they maintain the binding, they maintain prolonged tonic contraction for hours with little energy use. There is no something which is called detachment, or there is no what? There is no hydrolysis of ATP to maintain the contraction or to sustain the contraction. The head of myosin will remain bound to the actin binding sites, and this can maintain prolonged tonic contraction for hours with little energy use of excitatory signals, neurotransmitters, or hormones. Stress relaxation response. Can stretch a lot and still maintains its tension. Can stretch a lot and still maintains its tension. Good for hollow organ. Good for hollow organ. What is the meaning of that? When you produce maintained stretch for a long time on the smooth muscle, they have the capacity to increase its length. They have the capacity to acquire new length to decrease the tension on their walls. But what's going regarding to the length tension relationship, can develop a maximum tension over a great range of lengths. This means that the length of the smooth muscle can increase maximally up to 2.5 times of its resting length compared to skeletal muscle. And what's going, they are going to produce the same tension. They are going to produce the same tension. No decrease in tension with the increase in length. No decrease in tension with increase in length. No energy storage. Why? Because they are economically using the ATP. Blood supplies enough oxygen to keep up with the slow anaerobic ATP synthesis. No need to store glycogen inside the muscle or creatine phosphate. If you would like to compare between skeletal, cardiac, and smooth muscle excitation contraction coupling, that is the skeletal muscle. When the action potential is spread along the T-tubule, we have activation of dihydropyridine receptors, opening of the rhinodine receptors released in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, releasing the calcium. With repolarization, calcium will not come from the sarcoplasmic reticulum and bump it to the sarcoplasmic reticulum again to produce muscle relaxation. In smooth muscle, calcium comes from the extracellular fluid and from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, bind with calmodulin to activate the myosin light chain kinase, and the myosin light chain kinase will produce phosphorylation of the head of myosin to produce smooth muscle contraction. Activation of the myosin light chain phosphatase or the myosin phosphatase inactivates the myosin light chain, and this will produce dephosphorylation of the head of myosin. Cardiac muscle. Spread of the excitation wave or depolarization open L-type calcium channel. L-type calcium channels produce calcium influx. Calcium influx stimulates more calcium release from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is called calcium-induced calcium release. Calcium-induced calcium release. This means that the calcium comes from the extracellular fluid, stimulates more calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, allowing the sliding of actin over myosin after binding with troponin, like in the skeletal muscle. So here calcium is coming from the sarcoplasmic reticulum only. Calcium here coming from both extracellular fluid and the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Here calcium coming from the extracellular fluid and sarcoplasmic reticulum. in skeletal and cardiac muscle. Calcium is going to bind with troponin C to produce the sliding of actin over myosin. Here, calcium binds with another protein, which is calmodulin, to activate the myosin light chain kinase enzyme. Cell produce phosphorylation of the head of myosin. In this table, we have a comparison among skeletal smooth and cardiac muscle. Regarding to the striations, this is present in skeletal and cardiac, not present in smooth muscle fibers. Actin and myosin present in all. Level of control, skeletal muscle is voluntary, while smooth and cardiac muscle involuntary. Neural input, the skeletal muscle are supplied by the somatic nervous system, smooth muscle and cardiac muscle by the automatic. Neuromuscular junction, it is present here in skeletal muscle. While we have a varicosities from the autonomic nervous or from the postganglionic autonomic nervous to the smooth and cardiac muscle. Hormonal control is present in smooth and cardiac muscle. Source of calcium in skeletal muscle, sarcoplasmic reticulum. In cardiac muscle and smooth muscle, it is extracellular fluid and sarcoplasmic reticulum. The calcium binding protein or the regulatory protein in skeletal and cardiac muscle, it is troponin. In smooth muscle, it is calmodulin. Gap junction is present in single unit smooth muscle fiber and in cardiac muscle. Pacemaker activity present in single unit smooth muscle fiber and in cardiac muscle. Myosin ATPase activity. Myosin ATPase activity the fastest in skeletal muscle, then intermediate in cardiac muscle, slowest in smooth muscle. Recruitment by increasing of the number of the contracting muscle fibers, increasing the number of contracting muscle fiber present in skeletal muscle and multi-unit smooth muscle fiber. Present in skeletal and multi-unit smooth muscle fiber.